morning all of you. We will continue with the history chapter, European powers in India. All right, so till now we have had a look at what mercantilism is, the major global trade routes, the different trading companies in India, and so we were having a look at the different trading companies in India. The last one is left, so today we will begin with the English East India Company. Page number 18. Turn your books to page number 18. All right, the English East India Company. Now the English company, here we can say the Britishers, they became the supreme naval power. Means they became the supreme power at sea. Their navy was the most powerful, all right, and very strong. And this they became the supreme power. How they became power number one? After defeating the Spanish Armada in 1588. Now, Spanish Armada was a fleet of 130 warships. So, after they defeated the Spanish Armada in Europe in 1588, they became the first naval power in Europe. And now, you know, they became anxious. They wanted to trade with Asian countries. And so, they organized a company to do the same, to trade with the East. So a group of English merchants, they organized a company to trade with the East, and on 31st December 1600, Queen Elizabeth I, she granted a charter. She granted an order to the company to trade in the East countries, alright, or to trade in the East. And the third voyage was undertaken under the leadership of Captain Hawkins. And he landed at Surat in India in 1612, and then he asked to set up a factory at Surat. He asked for permission to set up a factory at Surat. Then in 1615, Sir Thomas Rowe, he was sent to the court of Jahangir, and he was sent by James I, King of England. And Thomas Rowe, he was able to get certain concessions for the English company from the Mughal Emperor. So he went to the Mughal Emperor and he asked for certain concessions that they can trade here freely, all right, and means not pay so much duties and all that, and to be given permission to open their factories at different places. So he was able to get certain concessions, certain grants from the English, from the Mughal Emperor. So the English East India Company, they were able to get certain grants, certain concessions from the Mughal Emperor. Okay, now the name of their company was East India Company, and the ambassador of King James I, his name was Hawkins, and he got a firman. Firman means an order. So he got a firman from the Mughal Emperor Jahangir, and he got an order to open a factory at Surat in 1609. But at that time Portuguese were already there, and so they secretly planned, because of the secret planning of the Portuguese there, this firman, it was withdrawn, it was taken back. And the English, they defeated the Portuguese in 1612 and again asked for permission from the Mughal Emperor to set up a factory in Surat. And in 1615, the English ambassador, Sir Thomas Rowe, he got the permission from the Mughal Emperor to open more factories, not only a factory at Surat, but more factories at Agra, Ahmedabad, and also Broach. They wanted to open factories in South more. Why? Because the conditions were favorable there. What were the favorable conditions in South? Because they did not have strong governments to face in the South. So, you know, easily they could get concessions and easily they can do their will. And so, for them, conditions were favorable to open up their factories in South. And in 1639, the English East India Company, they established the city of Madras. And, they got a piece of land from the Raja of Chandragiri. So they got a piece of land from the Raja of Chandragiri on the eastern coast of India, and there they established the city of Madras. Here they also built a fort and named that fort fort Saint George around the factory. So around the factory, they also built up a fort and called it the Fort of Saint George. Then in 1650, the company, the East India Company we are talking about, got the permission to carry on the trade in Bengal also. Earlier, you know, they were carrying on the trade in Carnatic area in south, but now they got the permission to carry on the trade in Bengal also. And Bengal, you know, it was the richest province at that time, and it was very rich, it was very productive also, and very huge province also. So obviously they were very happy when they got the permission to carry on trade in Bengal. And so, you know, they set up their factories at Hooghly and also at other places. Then Charles II, who was the King of England, he gave permission to the company in 1661 to issue coins. Means the British government, they gave the East India Company, who were in India trading, so they gave them the permission to also issue coins, that they can issue coins and they can build forts, they can even maintain their army in India, and as and when, you know, required, they can even wage a war, and or they can even, and even if they are at war with someone, so they can even declare peace. So according to the circumstances, permission was given to the East India Company to do likewise. So they can have their own army, and even if they want it, they can start a war against any kingdom here. Then Charles II, he also handed over the island of Bombay. Now island of Bombay he got from Portugal at the time of his marriage with the Portuguese princess. So he had already got the island of Bombay. Bombay, the city of Bombay, you know, as dowry. So Charles II has got Bombay as dowry from the Portuguese, and so he gave that Bombay, the city of Bombay, to the company in 1668. So 1668, the English, they also got Bombay. And after this, in 1691, the company, they got the exemption of customs duty in Bengal. Means they did not have to pay the custom duty. You know, when you indulge in trade, internal trade, external trade, all right, incidental national trade or international trade, then you have to pay certain duty. That is called as custom duty when you move from one custom barrier to another. So you have to pay certain duties, certain taxes, all right. But in 1691, the company, they got the exemption. That now they don't have to pay custom duty in Bengal, but in return for the custom duty, they had to pay 3,000 rupees a year to the Nawab of Bengal. So they had to pay 3,000 rupees per year and no custom duty throughout the year. Then in 1689, the company, they developed three villages in Bengal. And they developed these three villages into a city and built Fort Williams around the factory. And this city later on came to be known as Calcutta. And so these three villages, they were developed together and formed a city out of these three villages. And that city is known as Calcutta. Now, by this time, the company, you know, they had become successful in eliminating, in removing the influence of the rival powers in India. And now, you know, they started to interfere in the political affairs of the Indian rulers also. And because the Indian political conditions had become quite weak, and no powerful ruler, no strong ruler was there, and no strong dynasty, the rulers, you know, always fighting with one another, and there was so much rivalry and enmity between the different kingdoms who were ruling here. And so, you know, the British, the English, they took advantage and they started to interfere in the government matters of the provinces or the states. All right, move on to Anglo-French rivalry in South India. Now we have seen that the Dutch, the Portuguese, the French, the English, the Danes also, they all came to India as traders. And so, you know, all wanted to make huge profits through trade. So the main purpose was that they wanted to make as much profit as possible. Now the center for all of them was same. So the center was same. They all wanted to trade with India, and from here they can make huge profits in trade. And so obviously if the center was the same, so obviously there was a feeling of competition among them, and as a result they became rivals of each other. They became enemies, rivals of each other, and they started to eliminate, remove each other from the Indian market. So like, you know, if we don't count the local traders and the businessmen, and we only count these trading companies. So for example, if there were five, and so each will get, if we divide equally, so each will get only 20% of the share. And so you remove one and you get 25%, you remove one more, you get 33.33%, and you remove one more, you get 50%. So you know, that is what they wanted. They wanted to increase their profit from trade. Now how to do, because there were so many there, there was so much competition. So what was the best way? To eliminate the competition, remove the competition from the scene, and then obviously you will get more share. So that is what they started to do, and in the end the English, they came out victorious, and they were successful in eliminating, in removing the Portuguese and the Dutch. But the French were still here till the end of the 18th century. Now both France and England, they were anxious. They wanted to establish their supremacy, their dominance in India. And so now, because only two were left and both wanted the same thing, so obviously wars started between them. And these wars are known as Carnatic Wars. Why Carnatic Wars? Because they were fought in the region which was called as the Carnatic. Now present day Tamil Nadu and southern Andhra Pradesh. So Tamil Nadu and parts of Andhra Pradesh, that was at that time the region of Carnatic. So because they were fought there, that is why they were called as the Carnatic Wars. Now what were the causes of these Carnatic Wars or this Anglo-French rivalry? Now both English and French, they have come to India as traders, and they wanted to amass. The word is wrongly written there, correct it. It should not be amaze, obviously not surprise. Amass, A-M-A-S-S. Amass means to accumulate, to gather together. Correct the spelling, amass, A-M-A-S-S. So you know, both wanted to get as much wealth as possible through trade with India. So that was one of the reasons why, you know, there was so much rivalry. Second, now you know, we studied about industrial revolution in the first chapter, and you know, because of industrial revolution, these powers of Europe, you know, they wanted to establish their colonies in different parts of the world, so that you know they can also get raw materials from there at cheap prices. Then you know they can also sell their finished products there, because these European countries, they were not so big and they were small, so you know they did not even have enough raw materials to supply their factories. And also once you make the products, then where to sell them? Their markets were also small. So you know, they needed markets also where they could send their things, their final outputs. And so you know, they set out to look for colonies. And so as a result of industrial revolution, you know, both England and France, they wanted to control the Indian market. Then you know, later on furthermore, they also came to know that they can also get raw material from India at cheap prices for their factories in Europe, and that also in large quantity. So earlier they simply wanted a share in the trade. Then they also got to know that okay, from here we can also get raw materials at cheap prices for our factories in Europe. And so the rivalries, it increased. Then politically also, India has become quite weak, and so you know, it was not difficult for them to win Indian territories. And as a result, not only you know they were rivals in matters of trade, but they also became political rivals, because each wanted to win over more Indian territories. Then the French, they had their headquarters at Pondicherry, and this was not very far from the British centers at Madras and at Calcutta. So this was also the reason. Then secondly, the English, you know, they had set up very close connections with the famous Jagat Sets, who were the bankers of the Nawabs of Bengal. So they got into this close connection with the Jagat Sets, the bankers, the richest bankers of of Bengal, and they were also the, you know, the bankers of the Nawab of Bengal. So obviously this was not liked by the French, and so wars between the English and the French, they were sure to break out. It was sure that wars will break out between the English and the French. And so we come to the First Carnatic War. Now the First Carnatic War, it was fought between the French and the English companies, and this was over the issue of the Mughal Suba. Suba is province, what we now call as states. So at that time they were called as the Suba or the provinces. So over the issue of the Mughal province of Carnatic. Now in this First Carnatic War, the English company, they lost Madras to French, and in 1714, through a treaty, Madras was handed over by the French to the English through a peace treaty. So through a peace treaty, they got Madras back. So though they lost it to French, but they got it back through a peace treaty. Then the Second Carnatic War, it was fought over the issue of succession, as to who would succeed as the next king, who would become the next Nawab. Now the French, they wanted Chanda Sahib as the next Nawab of Carnatic, whereas the English, they supported Muhammad Ali. Again, both were supporting two different people. Obviously, you know, rivalry was already there. So again, it led to the Second Carnatic War. And in this war, the French, they were defeated, and Muhammad Ali, he was recognized as the Nawab of Carnatic. Alright, then the Third Carnatic War. Now, when the 7 years war, it broke out between the French and the English in Europe. So, you know, it was not only that the English and the French, they were fighting here in India only and because of trade. They were, they are said to be traditional rivals in Europe also. So, they were at war in Europe also. And, you know, so the 7 years war, it broke out between the French and the English. You know, Spain was also involved. Then Prussia and Austria were also involved in this 7 year wars. But here we are concerned only about the English and the French. And that is why we are talking that when the 7 year war, it broke out between the English and the French. So we can say that the last phase of this war was fought, and the last phase of this 7 years war was the Third Carnatic War, which started between the English and the French in India. So the 7 year war already going on between the English and the French in Europe. The last phase of that particular war was fought in India between the English and the French. Okay, so in 1760, the Third Battle of Carnatic, it was fought at Vandivash, and in this particular war, the French, they were very badly defeated by the English forces. So the English forces were led by General Sir Eyre Coote, and as a result, because, you know, they were so badly defeated by the English, so the French, they lost their possessions in India, and later on a peace treaty was signed between England and France in 1963. It could not be 1963, should be 1763. Correct it in your books, it should be 1763. So through the peace treaty of 1763 between France and England, the French company, you know, it was given back its territories. So though it was given back its territories, but you know, it was now not allowed to keep an army, it was not allowed to keep the troops. And so, you know, without army, without troops, so their dream of establishing an empire in India, it was dashed, it was crushed to the ground, it was broken. All right and the English, now they established their supremacy in India, and now, you know, from here they were the only trading company here, and you know, they have become very strong by now, and so now they can go ahead and also conquer or win over India. All right so why the French lost this battle, this war, and the British, they were successful? So the reasons for the success and the failure of the French. Now, there were many reasons that why the English were successful and the French were defeated. Let's have a look at some of the main reasons. Now, the first one. Now, the British, they had better settlements in India as compared to the French. So, their settlements at Bombay, Calcutta and Madras, they were much better settlements as compared from the French settlements at Mahe, Chandernagar and Pondicherry. both from the commercial point of view and also from the military point of view. So the Britishers, they had better settlements in India as compared to the French. So that was also one of the reasons of their successes. The English, you know, they had better financial condition. They were better money-wise, and you know, even at times of war, they never neglected their business. So, you know, though even if they were fighting with someone here in India or in Europe, but you know, they never neglected their business. And whereas, you know, the French trading company, they were always suffering big losses in trade. So they always kept their eyes on their goal, and so they were in a better monetary condition. Then the British, they had full control over the sea routes, means they were much better at sea. Their sea power was much superior to that of the French. Then the English, they got full support from their government, from their British government. So they got full support from the British Parliament, whereas the French company, they did not get so much support from their home government in France. Then one of the main reasons also we can say that why the English were successful in India was the reason that was Prime Minister Pitt's policy. Now, you know, he contributed, his policies, they contributed a lot to the successes or to the success of English in India. Now, you know, he managed to deal with the situation in Europe in such a way that he kept France busy in wars at Europe. So, you know, their mind was taken up with these wars in Europe. So they were busy fighting wars in Europe between England and France. And so, you know, they could not pay much attention to what was going on in India, and they could not even send their troops here, their people here, and money, and also the ammunition, the, you know, the guns, the bullets and artillery required to fight the English. They could not send it here, and so this was also one of the main reasons of the defeat of the French and the success of the English. Now, after these Carnatic Wars, the conflict, now you know, in Carnatic South, the English, they have established their supremacy, their dominance, and now this conflict, it shifted from South India to Bengal, and here East India Company, you know, they had a factory at Kolkata. Then in 1757, the French lost Chandernagar. They had a factory in Chandernagar in Bengal. They lost that factory to the British. And in the same year, that is 1757, Robert Clive, he laid the foundation of British Empire in India. And this he did by defeating Siraj ud-Daulah, who was the Nawab of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa in the Battle of Plassey. You know, at that time, the province of Bengal, it comprised of present-day Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. So many times when we say Bengal, referring to that time, we mean the whole thing. We mean the present-day provinces, present-day states of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. So it was a very huge province. Okay. Now, the English, you know, we have already seen that through these Carnatic Wars and all, they have established their supremacy in the south. And now, you know, they were ready to expand and spread their wings in other directions also. And now, what they did through betraying, by deceitful means, by lies, what they did, the British, they pitted one ruler against the other. They made one Indian ruler fight with the other ruler, and this they did by, you know, sometimes betraying one ruler, saying we'll help you, and at the last moment withdrawn their help, or they, you know, told lies, and they used lies, they misinterpreted the truth, misled the people, the rulers. And so somehow what they did, through all these wrong ways, they made one Indian ruler fight with the other. And you know, after the decline of the Mughals, you know, the greater Mughals, they were very strong and powerful rulers. But after them, we had the lesser Mughals. And you know, they were not so powerful and strong and able rulers. So they were not able to keep the entire empire, you know, united and strong. And so after the decline of the Mughals, Bengal, it was ruled by independent rulers. So independent rulers were ruling over there, and Aliwardi Khan, he ruled over Bengal and Orissa from 1740 to 1756. Now Aliwardi Khan, he was a good, a strong, able ruler, and he understood that what were the real intentions of the British, and so he understood that the British, they wanted to establish themselves not only as a trading power in India but also as a political power. Means they wanted to take control over India, and so you know what he did, he tried to keep them in check. So they were not allowed to fortify their settlements. Anyone here knows the meaning of fortify? Fortify, anyone here? Class? Okay, what is a fortress? Fortress, fortify, fortification, anyone? Can you tell me what is a fortress or fort? Joshita, Tahura, Nusra, anyone? Ishita? Come on, class. At least a yes or no? Yes?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. So, you know, fortification. Basically, what they did, you know, at that time, they used to build those huge, thick, huge defensive walls as a defense, as a security, so that the others will not attack you. So the English, they were not allowed to make these huge defensive walls around their settlements, means where they were living. They wanted to fortify that, they wanted to build these huge thick, you must have seen in movies and all that, you know, at that time the cities, they used to have these huge thick and very high walls around the city. Have you seen that in movies and all?
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is what is called as known as fortification. And so, you know, they were not allowed to fortify their settlements there. Then, so Aliwardi Khan, till the time Aliwardi Khan, he was ruling in Bengal, you know, he kept the English in check. But in 1756, Aliwardi Khan died, and the son of his youngest daughter, he became the Nawab of Bengal, the next Nawab of Bengal. And now, you know, Siraj-ud-Daula, he was the son of his youngest daughter. Obviously, there were more people in his family who wanted to be the next Nawab. But the son of his youngest daughter, he got to be the Nawab. So, obviously, you know, his relatives did not like him, and they wanted to overthrow. They planned to overthrow him, or they planned to remove him from his position. And the Britishers, they tried to take advantage of this political instability. You know, one strong ruler dies, another ruler comes to the throne, and now he is not liked by his officials, his own family, and everyone is trying to pull him down, all right, to remove him. So obviously, you know, he won't be able to maintain a very strong empire, because his whole attention would be, you know, how to first maintain his throne. And so the British, they tried to take advantage of this situation, and you know, they tried to take advantage of this situation to take advantage from this instability in Bengal. How they tried to take advantage and all that, we will study tomorrow. As of now, we will stop here. Okay, so whatever we did today, were you all able to understand? Is it clear to all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.